Joyful Lord, we adore thee, and in my life I put none before thee. Cause since I was a youngster, I came to know that you was the only way to go. So I had to go and come to an understanding that I'm down with the king, so now I'm the man. So you tell me who you down to see, cause all I know, I'm down with G-O-D. You down with G-O-D?
Yeah, you know me.
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 Come and join the chorus, the mighty, mighty chorus.
It's great, great to be here with you, London School of Theology Choir, and loving the welcome and the clapping as well. So let me just say from the very beginning that if you want to move or dance or whatever, some of you are like, don't ask me again, Geraldine. But if you want to move or dance, please feel free, because this time will go so quickly, and we're on a plane on Monday. So let's seize the day, yeah? Let's seize the moment. So do take a moment just to feel free as we party tonight in the presence of God. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome. This next song is called Melodies from Heaven.
Melodies from heaven.
us out. Lord, you are good.
Not even. Yeah. Lord, have mercy
Lord, you hear the sound of the proud ones laughing. Lord, you hear the sound of the childless hoping. Lord, you hear the sound of those in debt and struggling. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. Break the heavens, Lord. You said the poor are not forgotten. Let your justice roar in mighty waves across the earth. Come and whisper peace
For the Lord, and one time for the court, and one round of applause for my guy, Carrie P. Loose on the court. I think we got one. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Harriet's youth, but I'm God's son. And I say, no, look at what God's did. No, real talk, look at what God did. On the main stage singing his praises, I phone Aspen and I tell her that we got this. This is God's plan, they can never stop this. Like, wait right there, can you stop my first? You saved this kid and I'm not your first. It's not by blood and it's not by birth, but oh my God, what a God I serve.
Thank you.
to introduce now our very own Sam, Timothy, and Amy to come and to minister to us a beautiful, beautiful song called Prayer.
Sorry, I'd like to just say a few words. As we were coming to, we decided to come to Malaysia. Naturally, I was appointed as team leader since this is my country. And when I was thinking about where to go, obviously KL, because our host church was DMC, my church. And then I thought about Penang. Of course, one of the reasons was the food. But the other reason also is because Penang is kind of like my second home. My mom is from Penang. My dad's father is from Penang. And I remember when I was just discussing with Geraldine about some of the things that we can do in Penang, one of it was that I really wanted to have all of us visit my grand auntie in her home to perform for her. At the time, my grand aunt was, she was ill. And as Daniel mentioned just now, my auntie Ching, so she's the niece of that grand aunt. Unfortunately, about 9 weeks ago, my grand aunt passed away. And although I was really sad that I didn't get to say goodbye to her, this amazing woman, she has done so much for I really love her so much, and my other grand aunt is here today, and some of my family members are here as well. And I just, even though we couldn't visit her, I would like to sing the song to her. Even though we couldn't visit her, but we would still like to pay tribute to my late grand aunt with this song.
Shut up.
time.
Worthy, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
With our God, is a holy God, yeah. Sometimes all you can do is just be. And one of the words our Holy God would say is, see, I'm making a way in the desert. I know what you're going through. Even if you feel like you're going through the fire, I will be with you. Oh, I hear some witnesses in the house. That's great. So just before our principal and friend Calvin comes to speak to us, we're going to sing some of these words from Isaiah 43. It says, see, I'm doing a new thing. Can you believe it? Can you see it? It's before your very eyes. Can you see it? Can you believe it? So as we sing this, maybe you want to hold before God, this holy God, a situation in your mind or in your heart or in your life. Maybe something that's intractable, something that is, you can't see a way through it. Can we invite you to hold that before our God, our holy God, and say, God, I have no other hope but you. So as we sing this, we pray that it will bless you and minister to you. Can you see it?
Through the dark night,
touch me out. Thank you so very much, guys. You've really ministered to me, and I'm sure you've ministered to so many others. I want to pick up where the choir left off from Isaiah chapter 43, from verse 1 to 4. It's the song they've just been singing. Now, my name is Calvin Samuel. I'm principal of London School of Theology. It's such a privilege to be here with you. I happen to be a Methodist. I didn't know we were coming to a Methodist place, so it's even more wonderful to be with you. Let me read you some verses of scripture. We'll pray, and then we'll see what the Lord has to say to us tonight. So Isaiah chapter 43 from verse 1. But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead, since you are precious and honored in my sight. And because I love you, I will give people in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Loving God, as we come to your word, we pray tonight that you would open up your word to our hearts and open up our hearts to your word so that you may change us. Amen. I have called you by name. You are mine. This text that we read tonight, and indeed I had no idea until today that that song that they sang was based on the same passage that I was going to preach tonight. And this is a passage which has been really significant for me, for my life and ministry. I wouldn't say it is my favorite Bible passage. I wouldn't say it is the most important in Scripture. But nonetheless, it has been for me a significant passage for my life and ministry. Tonight I want to give you part sermon and part testimony. So please forgive me if I talk about myself a little bit. But this text became really important for me at an early stage of public ministry. I was in my second year as a Methodist minister, a probationer, if those of you know what that is. And I was coming up to be ordained in the summer. And we invited a group, a lay witness group, to come to our church to work with us. And one of the things they did with us for that week as they worked with us was that they offered us directed prayer. One of that group, they would choose a passage of scripture which they felt led to share. And they would invite one of us to meditate and reflect upon that passage, and then that would shape their prayers. And we divided our day into 1 hour slots. So each day, each hour, someone would be in the church praying with a member of that team. And that team each hour would choose a passage that they felt led, meditate on it, and then they'd pray for that hour. And the highlight of that week for me was when this passage, Isaiah 43, was selected. It was offered to me for reflection. I have called you by name, you are mine. Isaiah 43, of course, refers to Israel, the people of God. It's a reminder to her of God's sacrificial and redeeming love, of God's grace. It describes that covenant relationship with God, a people he called out of Egypt. It is a text that reminds us that whatever faces us, we can look it in the eye because we face it with Jesus Christ. Let me check something tonight. How many people have been in the fire? Anybody? Oh, come on, there's more of you than that. How many of us have felt that we are in deep, deep waters? Anybody? It's this God who says, I am with you. This is a text that's written to people who are in exile. And it reminds them that they are not forgotten. They are not abandoned. They are not cast aside. I have called you by name, and you are mine. Isaiah 43 is a promise to Israel and a promise to the church that the God of Israel, who has redeemed us and sustains us, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers, you will not be overwhelmed. When you go through the fire, you will not be consumed. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Friends, I've got to tell you, this is a magnificent piece of scripture. I'd like to give you some homework. I know you're not in theological college, but homework anyway. When you go home, read this passage. If you don't have a Bible, download one onto your phone and read it. But you know, even though this is such a magnificent piece of scripture, on that day when it was offered to me in my meditations, all of that was lost on me. Because I didn't hear any of that. Let me tell you what I heard that day. Because in that passage where it says, I have called you Jacob and formed you Israel, that is not what I heard. What I heard were my own names. Thus saith the one who created you, Calvin, and the one who formed you, Timothy. It sounded a bit like this in my mind. Thus said the Lord, he who created you, O Calvin, he who formed you, O Timothy, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. In order to understand why this passage was so significant for me, I need to tell you a little bit about my testimony. I grew up in a Christian home. Not only were my parents Christians, but their parents also were Christians. Bible-believing, church-attending, seeking more of God kind of Christians. And I give God thanks for them. My parents met in the village church where I attended, in the youth group. And their parents were there before them. So whenever I went to church, there was a lot of Samuels in the house. My uncles, my aunties, my cousins, it was wonderful. And of course, my grandparents. At 16, I was baptized, received into full membership in that church in the Caribbean island of Antigua, where I grew up, where four generations of my family have worshipped. And they continue to worship there to this day. In that church graveyard, my father is buried. Two of my aunts are buried. My uncle is buried. Their parents are buried. Our roots go deep in that church. But one of the things that always troubled me as a teenager and growing up was that despite growing up in this profoundly formative and supportive network of Christians, I was the only one of my siblings who had found faith in Jesus Christ. I had two brothers, two sisters. None of them were interested in faith apart from me. We'd all attended the same church. We'd all gone to the same Sunday school. We'd all been part of the same youth fellowship. We'd had the same example set to us by our parents and grandparents and uncles and aunties. We were exposed to the same teaching and preaching and Christian witness. And yet I was the only one who had a living faith in Jesus Christ. And I never could understand why that was. I thank God that the situation is different now. Two of my siblings, one of my brothers and one of my sisters, have come to a wonderful saving faith in Jesus Christ. We continue to pray for the other two. But as a young man, I was very much alone. And I did not understand. Because let me tell you, friends, I was not the obvious choice of my brothers and sisters to be the one to become a Christian. I was not the brightest of that bunch. I was not the best behaved of that bunch. I was not the nicest of that bunch. And it did not make any sense to me why the gospel should make sense to me, but not to my two brothers or to my two sisters. And then, when I turned 21, I felt called to ministry. And that question became even more significant. Why in the world would God save me? Why in the world would God call me into ministry? And my sisters and brothers have no sense of Christ. And the question I ask is simply this, why me? Because let me assure you, friends, if I were God, and let's all be grateful that I'm not God, but if I were God, and I were going to call one of those five children into Christian faith and into Christian ministry, let me assure you, I would not have chosen this one. If God wanted the brightest and the sharpest tool in that box of five kids, this wouldn't be the one he'd end up with. If God wanted the one who was the most people-focused, the most caring, the most pastoral, God wouldn't have chosen this one. If God were looking for the most disciplined, the most principled, God would not have chosen this one. If God were looking for the most attractive personality of those five kids, again, not me. I can assure you, whatever measure that you might use to select from those five kids, you were never going to end up with me as the one you would choose. And so all the way, as I struggled with the call to ministry, as I trained as a minister, as I entered into full-time ministry as a probationer, that question never left me. And the question was simply this: why me? And then we get to that morning. There I am with a stranger from a lay witness group. It's 6 a.m. This person that I've met only once before, 2 days earlier, says to me, "The Lord has given me a passage for you to meditate on." And it's this passage, Isaiah 43, verse 1 to 4. And what I heard that day continues to sustain me to this day. I have called you by name, and you are mine. Friends, when God calls us, it is not a mistake. When God calls, it is not an oversight. When God calls you into relationship, it is not because God could not do any better. It is because God in grace has chosen to pursue you and to call you by your name. Friends, I think our names are really important because we inhabit our names so that our names become more than merely what we are called. They become who we are. Would you like to do an exercise with me? How many of you like your names? Anybody? You really like your name? Okay. And how many of you are not so keen on your name? Anybody? You want to have a little conversation with your parents to say, "What were you thinking?" Am I the only one who doesn't like bits of my names? Okay. I think if you live in Western culture, you very quickly lose the significance of a name that describes who you are. In the Bible, we often see people who need a new name to describe the new reality after they have had a transformative encounter with the Holy God of Israel. We see this happening again and again. So Abram, after he meets with God, becomes Abraham. Sarai, after she encounters God, becomes Sarah. Saul, after he meets Jesus on the road to Damascus, becomes Paul. Simon becomes Peter. And of course, in this passage, we are reminded that Israel was initially called Jacob. The name that his parents gave him was Jacob, but the name that God gave him was Israel. And that's why in this passage you get God saying, "I am the one who created you, O Jacob," the name that your parents give you. "And I am the one who formed you, Israel," the name that I gave you. Because names, I think, say something about us, for good or for evil. And I think those of you who like your names probably like what your names say about you. And those of us who don't like our names, we just don't like what our names say about us. So my name is Calvin. Would you like to know what my name means? I looked this up, and I discovered that my name, Calvin, it means, wait for it, bald one. That's what it means. One with no hair. Let me tell you, my older brother has a full head of hair. My younger brother has a full head of hair. They call me bald one. This is what happens. But my middle name is the name I prefer. My middle name is Timothy. Any Timothys in the house? All right. Timothy is a wonderful name. Because you see, Timothy comes from a Greek name, Timotheos, which is two words. Theos meaning God, and Timo meaning honor. So Timothy is one who honors God. That's an awesome name. It's a challenging name to live up to. But let me tell you, I would much rather be a Timothy, one who honors God, than a Calvin, a bald one. But one of the reasons I love my middle name is a story I heard my father saying to someone else. To this day, he has never told me this story. When I was 24 years old, I was leaving Antigua, tiny island in the Caribbean, to move to Britain to train for ministry. At the time, I was a member of my church board, and my father happened to be a member of the church board, and it was the last board meeting before I left the country. And so they all gathered round, and they said nice things about me, and they prayed for me. And they went round the board, each one saying what they had to say. And my father, who happened to be on the board, it was a very awkward situation, father and son on the board, he told this story. I had never heard it before, and the only reason he told it was because he was saying it to other people. And he said when he was a young man, as he was having children, he prayed to God that one of his sons would become a pastor. And of course, he was of that generation who believed it would have to be one of his sons. It didn't occur to him it could be one of his daughters. And my older brother tells me that he was aware that my father had been praying this prayer, and he made a very silent commitment that it would definitely not be him. But I, of course, had no idea that my father had been praying when we were born that one of his sons would become a pastor. And then comes the twist. My father is not someone who ever really says God said anything to him. But one of the things he said was this. When he was born, I felt very strongly God saying to me, this one must be called Timothy. And I've only now worked out that my prayer to God, I would like one of my sons to become a pastor and serve you. And that instruction from God, this one should be called Timothy. Maybe those two things are connected. And I have to say, what I said to my father was, let me get this right. God told you to call me Timothy and you call me Calvin? My father's a lawyer. His response was, God did not tell me which order to give you the names. I think West Indian parents are like Chinese parents. They are always right. Amen? I remembered all of that morning as I heard this passage read to me. Thus says the Lord, who created you, Calvin, the name chosen by my parents, and he who formed you, Timothy, the name chosen by God. Do not be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Let me tell you, I cried that day because I was reminded of the enormity of God's grace. Here is a God that doesn't really care where you've been. A God who doesn't really care what you've done. A God who does not choose you because you are brilliant, because you are gifted, because you are good, because you are able. But a God who calls you because he is God and he is love. Friends, I don't know what your situation is today. And it may be like me that you wrestle with this idea that this God calls you by name. I believe there are some people here tonight who've heard the call of God in their hearts and their lives. But some of you have not responded personally. You may have been in church all your life, a bit like my sisters and brothers. They've heard the gospel, went to church, part of the Sunday school, part of the youth fellowship, but they did not make a commitment to God. That might be you tonight. I want to remind you that God is here and he's saying, I have called you by your name. He's calling you into deep relationship. There are some of you here who know exactly what I'm talking about. You have been in relationship with God. But somewhere along the line, you've drifted away from it. Your passions have grown cold. You've fallen out of love with God. You've left behind your first love. and right now all you're doing is going through the motions. My taxi driver today tells me he used to go to church, but he stopped going because he found that in order to keep up with church, he had to become a hypocrite. Because in fact, he no longer was carrying around inside of him what he was professing. We had a little chat about that, and I realized, you know what, he's not alone. There are lots of us in church for whom there is a gap between what we present in church and what's really going on in our lives. And that might be you tonight. And if that is you, let me remind you that God is calling you back into deep relationship, and he is calling you by name. Andrew, Patricia, Chen, Janet, thus says the Lord who created you, he who formed you, do not be afraid. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name because you are mine. And finally, there are some of you here tonight who are being called into more costly forms of ministry. You're already committed to Christ. You're already doing your bit for God, for the church. God sees your heart. But tonight he is actually calling you into a more costly form of ministry, a more sacrificial and fully committed form of Christian service. And he's calling you by name. Will you respond to him today? Will you respond to him tonight? Thus says the Lord, he who created you, he who formed you, do not be afraid. I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. I'm going to pray in a moment. But I wonder if there are some of you who need to do some business with God tonight. If you're here and you've never given your heart to Christ, if you've never given him your full commitment, here's a moment where you can do that. If you found yourself drifting, here's a moment where you can come back to God. If you recognize tonight that you're being called into a more costly form of ministry and service, here's your moment tonight. So let's pray. Loving God, thank you that you are a God who calls us by name. You know who we are even before we are born. And you call us by name. You know what we have done. And you know what has been done to us. And yet you still love us and you call us by name. And there is nothing that we can do which would put us outside the reach of your love. You pursue us by your grace. So Lord, I pray for those tonight who will come to you. Give them courage. Give them wisdom. Fill them with your grace. In the name of Jesus, amen. Is there anyone here tonight, if you just put your hand up, that God is calling you into a new relationship, calling you into a deeper relationship, calling you into more Christians, deeper Christian service? Is that you? I can see a couple of hands. Anyone else who's prepared tonight to say, God, I hear your call, and I'm saying yes. Don't let this moment pass you by. We can wait for a moment. Here's an opportunity to respond to the God who sees you, who knows you, who loves you, and who is pursuing you right now. Is there anyone who will respond to Jesus? One of the wonderful things we've been experiencing over the last few weeks
is something of the grace of God. People we've met, we do not believe that they are by chance. Some of the encounters we've had have been years in the making. I do not believe you are here by chance tonight. So here's a moment for you. Is there one who will respond? Got a number of people who will pray with you. And I wonder if I can invite them to come now. And I'm going to invite the choir to come back. They're going to lead us in some more worship and singing. We'll be here. If you would value having someone to pray with you, the team here would be delighted in confidence to pray. Whether that's praying for salvation, saying to Jesus, look, Lord, I've heard about this. I want to make a commitment to you tonight. These guys will be delighted to pray with you. If you know that there's a gap between the person you are in church and the person that you are in private, here's a moment. There are people who'll be delighted to pray with you. And if you're one of the people feeling a real tug that God is calling you into deeper Christian service, again, there are folks we would love, we would count it a privilege to pray with you tonight. So as the choir sings, can I invite you to come? And we would love to pray with you. Let's take the moment. Geraldine, will you take us away? I wonder if I can invite you to stand with us. As the choir keeps singing, Christ is enough for me. I wonder if you would just join us in singing, Christ is enough for me.
Did you all have a good evening? Did you all have a good evening tonight? Yeah? Thank you. Before we finish with the last song, I would like to sing one more song first. What day is it on Monday? Malaysia Day, that's right. So, sorry, tomorrow. Tomorrow's the 16th, right? I'm sorry, I got my dates wrong. Tomorrow is Malaysia Day. So this song, I'm sure most of you will know. My favorite lines of this song are the first two lines. Puji dan syukur pada ilahi. Praise and thanks be to God. And the second line, anugrahnya tiada terhingga. Which is his gifts knows no limits. And this year, I think, has really been an important year for us because it is truly a sign of God's faithfulness to our country. And so even as we sing this song together, may we just reflect on how good God has been to us as a country. Public holiday, especially, remember to pray for our country as we still need more prayers. And thank you for having us all. Thank you, Trinity Methodist Church. Really, we have felt so welcome here. Thank you all very much. Can you just give another hand to the LSP choir and the band?
Thank you. Have a good night.